talented and accomplished and a wonderful person. Savannah-based curator and writer Tania Sammons tells interesting stories about people, art, architecture, history, and culture. She has produced dozens of exhibitions, including Slavery and Freedom in Savannah, Assembled and Cast, a Celebration of Contemporary Glass, Beyond Utility, Pottery Created by Enslaved Hands, The Art of Khalil Gibran, The Story of Silver in Savannah, Creating and Collecting Since the 18th Century, and Gaming Tables for Whist, Chess, and Other Amusements. For the city, she wrote the work Daphne Park, The First 100 Years, 1907 through 2007. And she's also written for 19th Century, Magazine Antiques, Institute du Monde Arab, University of Georgia Press, Georgia Museum of Art, University of Maryland, Telford Museums, and many others. She's received numerous awards, grants, and scholarships, and her award-winning work includes the exhibition, publication, and community partnerships for Telford Slavery and Freedom in Savannah, which I think many of you probably got to see some of that work, which is really good. And we have the publication down in the library and archive downstairs. She received the 2014 Khalil Gibran International Award, and recently the 2016 Brown Foundation Fellowship from the Museum of Fine Arts Houston at the Dora Maar House in France. She's currently serving as the Green Collection Curator at the Green Meldrum House and is writing a guidebook for the Andrew Lowe House, as well as a biography about philanthropist, educator, and traveler Mary Haskell Minus. She's also an expert on William Jay, so that's why we've invited her here to tell us a little bit about Jay and his work in Savannah.
Thank you, Luciana. As Luciana mentioned, we've known each other for a long time, and part of our friendship stems from architecture. We spend a lot of time talking about architecture. Not many friends I have that I hang out and talk about architecture, so I appreciate that, Luciana. And thank you for inviting me to speak here today about William Jay, who I find quite fascinating, and I hope at the end of this presentation that you will walk away and go check out some of his buildings in Savannah and hopefully think about him and the city in a different way, because it's really, William Jay had a really great impact on the city and how the city looks today. So we think about William Jay through these houses, usually. The Owens-Thomas House, the Haversham House, which is now Ships of the Sea Museum, the Bullock House. Some of you might not be so familiar with this house. I'll talk a little bit more about it in a minute. This was torn down in the early 20th century. It was located across from the Champion Harper Folks House on Orleans Square in the parking lot where the Civic Center is, and Telfair Mansion. This is sort of a glimpse of William Jay, and what I'm going to do is sort of jump back in time and talk about influences. When we think about William Jay and Savannah and the impact that he had, one of the things that's really important is the contrast of architecture at the time when he comes to Savannah. So you have here the first house that he designed in the city, the Owens-Thomas House, in contrast to a contemporary building in the city, the Davenport House. The house on the left, it's often referred to as neoclassical or Regency architecture. Essentially, this is an English house plopped down in the city of Savannah. On the right side, you have the Davenport House, which is federal architecture. You'll see this kind of architecture along the East Coast throughout the United States. So I want to talk a little bit about William Jay's influences sort of leading up to his work in Savannah. And it begins with Andre Palladio, who was a 16th century Italian architect working primarily in the area around Venice. He was very influential on architects afterwards. And so essentially all architects study Palladio. Even if they reject his ideas, they study his work. And one of the things that was really important about Palladio's architecture was that he was referencing Greek and Roman architecture, and he recorded his drawings in books, which were widely distributed, which allowed his work to be studied. You see his work translated into works in England. So you have on Chiswick, and these are two examples. Chiswick House in London and Holcombe Hall in Norfolk. Both of these are early to mid 18th century works that were designed by an amateur architect, an English amateur architect, Lord Burlington, and the architect William Kent. And you see Palladio's work coming out in this architecture and other examples in this time period. Another reference, an important reference for William Jay and architects of the period, and even today, is Giovanni Battista Piranesi, excuse me, who was an Italian draftsman and artist, and he created these, excuse me, he created these engravings and prints that were widely distributed, and he's often considered even an archaeologist because of his work. He was going around in the 18th century looking at Roman and Greek ruins, and he paid really special care. He wanted to make sure that he was creating or representing them as realistically as possible. And a lot of these ruins have greatly decayed or no longer exist, and so it's a real reference for us today. Then we look at Robert Adam. Robert Adam was an architect who originally came from Scotland and primarily worked in England. He went on the Grand Tour, which is a lot of architects did this, which ultimately included traveling throughout Italy looking at Greek and Roman architecture. And Robert Adam was a student of Piranesi, the artist that we saw here. And he worked under him, and he became quite accomplished himself, and he ended up publishing a number of books of his own work, as well as drawings of antiquity as well. Most famously, he was known for the ruins of Diocletian Palace, which Diocletian was a Roman emperor, and he built a palace in what is today Croatia, and I'll come back to that a little bit later. These are some examples of Robert Adam's works in different parts of London, or excuse me, England. This house, I'm going to spend a few moments talking about this house. This is Kettleston Hall in Derbyshire, partially designed by Robert Adam, including the south front that you see here. A lot of these country houses were immense. They weren't human scale. They're really public scale. When you see the interior of this, you'll really get a feel for what I'm talking about. But these houses were so immense and so beautiful and so over the top that the owners didn't want to keep them to themselves. And so not only would they have lots of parties and invite their friends there, but they would also open them to the public. And this house in particular was open to the public very early on, shortly after it was built, completed. And the housekeeper would actually take people through parts of the house. I don't know if William Jay had the opportunity to visit some of these houses, but I strongly suspect that he did, in part because his father was an evangelical minister, non-denominational minister, and he grew up from Bath, England, and he grew up in Bath. But his father, he had a church based in Bath that he traveled extensively throughout England. And William Jay was his oldest son, and he likely would have traveled with him. And as they're traveling around, would have likely visited places like Kettleston Hall. Also, his grandfather was a stonemason. So this was something that they were interested in and thought about. One thing I want to point out here is to look at this architecture here and how these architects are referencing Greek and Roman architecture. So this is the Arch of Constantine in Rome. And you see the front of the facade, the south facade designed by Robert Adam on your left, and the Arch of Constantine from Rome on your right. And you see how much the ancient architecture is influencing the architecture in England. This is a cross-section of Kettleston, and so the facade that we were just looking at was right here. But when you actually came up to the house, you would come in this direction. And I'm going to show you an interior view of these two spaces. And I just want you, as I show you these images, keep these in mind as you think about William Jay's work later on. What William Jay is doing is he's taking a lot of these design elements, which were presented in very grand ways in many of these country homes, and he's reducing it to a more modest scale with the residences that he creates in Savannah and elsewhere. So these are interior shots of the front area coming into the front entrance. These are skylights here that are lighting this area. You can see the scale here. These are people. This is regular scale. And then you go through this doorway right here, and this is the ceiling in the dome. And this is referencing the Pantheon in Rome. So moving forward in time, we jump to John Nash, who is active in the late 18th and early 19th century. John Nash is connected to the Prince Regent, the Prince of Wales, who was very interested in architecture and design and the arts. And he was very influential on the design world as it evolved in England in the late 18th and early 19th century. The term regency actually comes from him, because he was the Prince Regent from 1811 to 1820, when his father, George III, was declared insane. And so he, the Prince of Wales, became the ruler of England. He later became George IV after his father died. So John Nash did a variety of work. So this is Brighton Pavilion here in Brighton, England. Very elaborate and sort of fantastical work that evolved over a long period of time with strong influence by the Prince Regent. And this is a more classical approach to John Nash's work in London. A little bit after William Jay's time period, but it gives you an idea of sort of the range that John Nash is working on. John Nash worked with a man, an architect and a surveyor named David Rydell Roper. And he was the architect that William Jay apprenticed to when he was in London. And I'll come back to him in a minute. Here are some interior shots of the Brighton Pavilion. One of the things that was very popular in this time period in late 18th century and early 19th century with interior design was painted ceilings. And you will see painted ceiling, you'll see the drawing room at the Owens-Thomas House has a painted ceiling, actually in a very similar manner to this. Very likely the dining room and the ceilings in many of the homes in Savannah were painted. William Jay's homes were painted, but the plaster's been replaced over the years, and so we're lucky that we at least have the drawing room in the Owens-Thomas House from this period. It's recreated based on paint analysis. Another thing that became very popular and used was skylights and playing with colored lights, and William Jay does a little bit of this. This is much, you know, this is beyond the scale of what William Jay is working on, but this is where it stems from. Then we have Sir John Soane. Sir John Soane is a contemporary of John Nash. He becomes the lecturer of architecture at the Royal Academy. And this is probably the most influential person of William Jay. He built this house at Lincoln's Inn Fields in London. He gave his lectures at the Royal Academy. This house he set up as sort of a museum of sorts, and he collected pieces from antiquity, and he would, so this section right here, this is his breakfast room, which I'm going to come back to this in a moment, in the main house. But then he added these sections to the back of his house. Look at all the skylights here, and what this is lighting, these areas below where he's collected these architectural fragments and statuary over time. And he encouraged, he also collected a lot of architecture books and drawings and prints, and he encouraged his architecture students to come to his home and explore his museum and the books that he had available. He was very generous. There's no, at least at this point that I know of, documentation that William Jay actually went to Sir John Soane's house, but I suspect that he did. He was an ambitious man, and he loved learning, and if he had the opportunity, I'm sure he would have gone. This is William Jay's father, the Reverend William Jay, who I mentioned. He was bigger than life. Everybody loved him. There are tons of prints and portraits of him. This is the house where he and the Jay family lived. And then to give you an idea of the environment where William Jay grew up, the Circus and Royal Crescent, designed by John Wood Jr., was constructed just a few years before William Jay was born in the late 18th century. And this is the also from the late 18th century, designed by John Wood Jr. and his father, the Elder, from the late 18th century. This is above the Roman baths that were found in Bath. And so this is the sort of architecture that William Jay is surrounded by as he grows up. This is an interior view of the Bath houses in Bath. This is Brockwell Hall in Brixton. So I mentioned that William Jay studies with an architect named David Rydell Roper. This is a house that he worked on while he was apprenticing with Roper. It's in Brixton, which is just outside of London. And there are some elements here that you see pop up later on in his work. You see the Ionic column, the capitals here. Here you see Greek key design. And then this is the entryway, just inside the entryway in the front hall here, which references the breakfast room that I pointed out. And I'll come back to this again, but just take note and I'll come back to that. The first building that we know or that we believe that he designed was a church in England, Albion Chapel. It no longer exists. It was torn down in the late 19th century. And then he comes to America. And the first house that he designs in the United States is the Owens-Thomas house in Savannah. And he actually designs the house in England, sends the plans over, and the house is under construction, and he arrives in late 1817. The house was constructed between 1816 and 1819. So how did he get to Savannah from London? So it's a family connection. So William Jay's sister Anne married a Savannian, Robert Bolton. And Robert Bolton's sister, represented by this tea service, because there is no portrait of her, but we know that this tea service belonged to her, Frances Bolton Richardson, married Richard Richardson, also no portrait, but represented by this house, his house, the Owens-Thomas house, what we call today the Owens-Thomas house, Richard Richardson's house. So William Jay meets Richard Richardson via this connection. Robert Bolton started out as a merchant. He partnered with Richard Richardson, but he left the business to become a minister. And he was a follower of Anne and William's father, William Jay, the Reverend William Jay, and he became a reverend, lived and practiced in England for a number of years, and then moved back to the United States, practicing in New Jersey. So William Jay gets to Savannah. He designs this Regency house for Richard Richardson. And what do you think the other wealthy guys in Savannah want to see happen? They want one of those too. This is not like anything anybody has seen in Savannah at this point. And so they all just jump on the bandwagon. So we have Alexander Telfair's house. and we have Robert Habersham's house, and we have Archibald Bullock's house. And then he begins to do public buildings as well. The Savannah Theater. there's an attribution that he actually designed the Judge Wayne's house, which is now the Juliet Gordon Low birthplace. There are no plans or documents that say that specifically, but William Jay was actually fined for debris beside the house. So he was somehow involved. And when you look at it, take off this top, which was added in the late 19th century. When you look at this house, you can see the similarities to the other houses that he designed in Savannah. A branch bank of the United States government, also torn down in the early 20th century. And then he's in Savannah, and he branches off, and there's evidence that he did some work elsewhere in Georgia, possibly in Augusta, maybe in the south of Savannah, in the Darien area, and he heads to South Carolina. And he is hired by South Carolina to serve as their government architect. And he designs a number of courthouses. And he was only there for a short period of time, around 1820, 1821. And Robert, the architect, American architect Robert Mills, he was from Charleston, ends up taking over that project. And so oftentimes, buildings that Jay originally designed are attributed to Robert Mills, either because he took over the project or he may have altered the original designs along the way. This is in Walterboro, a courthouse in Walterboro. And he also designed some residences in Charleston as well. This is the William Mason Smith House. This is a contemporary image of the house. This is an image taken in 1886 when the earthquake hit. And you can see part of the house fell off, and this is a dome at the top of the staircase, and I'll show you some images of the staircase in a moment. So he's in Charleston for a short period of time. Really, he's in America for a very short period of time, late 1817 to about 1821, 1822, and he's back in England. There was a huge financial failure in America in 1819, and many of his clients lost their money, and so there wasn't the solvency to create new architecture at this time. So he goes back to England. He ends up doing a lot of work in Gloucestershire, which is the big city there is Cheltenham. If you drive that distance today, it's probably an hour and 15 minutes north of Bath. And it was sort of a boom town. It was a spa town. So Bath was a spa town. It was very popular in the 18th century. Cheltenham became very popular in the 19th century. And he goes and he designs a number of terraces or row houses. And I'm going to flip through a number of these to show you some buildings. I went there in 2009, and there was a woman who lives in Cheltenham who I was connected to, and she had written a small little article about William Jay and the works that he had designed, the buildings he had designed in Cheltenham several years before. And I met her, and she reached out to me and said, please come, I'll show you around, and please stay at my house. And so my whole family and I actually went and stayed in the basement of her house. And before I went to visit, she went around to all these different, the owners of all these different homes designed by William Jay, and said, there's an American curator coming to study William Jay's architecture. Can we come in your house? And so she got me inside of all these houses, which was so amazing. And then I found out that she didn't even do this when she was writing the article for her paper much earlier, because English people don't do that. You don't invite yourself into somebody's house. And I learned that especially from this couple right here. This is the Paragon Buildings. It was a terrace or row house, six houses that William Jay designed. And the woman, I'm drawing a blank on their names, but the woman who was showing me around, she met this woman, and she was an American, and she was from, I believe, St. Louis. And she was just so welcoming and open. And we went through, she took us through closets. I mean, we went top to bottom throughout the entire house. And then she kept making reference to her neighbor. And well, my neighbor tells me that he has this in his house. And my neighbor says this, and my neighbor. And I said, well, have you seen your neighbor's house? And she said, no, he hasn't invited me in. And so they've been neighbors for 3 years. And I said, she said, he's over here all the time, but he's never invited me in. She said, but I'm gonna call him. And so she calls up the neighbor. He comes over, he hangs out in the house for a little while, and then he says, oh, why don't you come over to my house? And so we all go over to his house and look all around. And it was really fantastic because you could see, one of the fun things about it is you could see the woman who was from America, a lot of work and a lot of changes had been done to her house that had not been done to his house. And this house had been in his family for a long time. So they hadn't done a whole lot of work there. Well, I'm gonna show you some interior shots of this a little bit later on. This is another building, or another terrace, row house, Columbia Place. This is Pitfield Parade. It actually ended up being 17 terraces or row houses, but Jay only designed two of them. And one of the things that you're kind of noticing here is we're progressing through time, and they're getting less grand. And so one of the things William Jay does is he becomes a speculator. And he's putting his own money into some of this work, and it caused him some troubles, and he later on went bankrupt. This is Priory Street, and this is a house nearby in Cirencester, which is about 20 minutes outside of Cheltenham. This was a freestanding home residence called Watermore House. And then he ends up working on a number of different buildings and renovations in England. And then he goes bankrupt. And then he takes on a position on the island of Mauritius in the Indian Ocean. And that was 1836. And there he designs the gate to the central market and a church. And then in 1837, he dies from a fever. And so when he dies, so he comes to Savannah in 1825, and he dies in his early 40s. So really relatively short lifespan for William Jay. It's kind of a sad ending. But I don't want to end there. I want to end with showing you some of the interiors and talk about some of the elements that I want you to look for when you go into the homes and around the homes in the city of Savannah. One of the things that William Jay does, which is typical of Regency architecture, is creating uniquely shaped rooms. And while you'll find square rectangular rooms in William Jay's houses, you'll also find rooms with curved walls, like the walls at the Owens-Thomas House. There are curved walls at the Ships of the Sea Museum, the Habersham House. This is Pitfield Parade in England. And in Cheltenham, and this is the Octagon Room in Telfair Mansion. I put these two slides over here as reference for works that had architecture in England. So this is a curved space just outside that dome, that grand domed hall that I showed you at Kettleston Hall, with the curved door. William Jay included curved doors in his curved walls. And another thing, a little detail that I think references how William Jay is trying to take this big scale and make it more modest, but still presents an architecture and a space to live in a grand way. So this is Kettleston Hall. These people obviously are extremely wealthy. And this is a silk wallpaper, and it's tacked down with this gilded wooden border. It's kind of faint to see there, but it goes all the way around. You can see it kind of right there. William Jay, when we did paint analysis several years ago at the Owens-Thomas house, the first color scheme was a red, and then there was this little border that went all the way around. The next color scheme was gray, with this darker gray border that went around the molding here. He's referencing, so he didn't, William Jay didn't use wallpaper, he used paint, but he's referencing that grander presentation in these grander homes with paint. So here are very grand rooms. This is the dining room of Kettleston. You can see this niche. This is inside the niche where these are not built-in sideboards, but they're sideboards specifically made for that space and fit in there. This is Hume Hall, Hume House, originally called Hume House, now called Home House in London, a townhouse in London. Again, this is designed by Robert Adam with these niches here in the walls and this curved space here in the dining room, the original dining room. This is the Owens-Thomas House. So again, a much more modest scale, but he's created a niche for the built-in sideboard, and then he's got this skylight above it. It's a grand room, but it fits the space on a more modest scale. Other things that he copied from other architects in England include these decorative moldings. And so this is from a boathouse in on the property where Kettleston Hall was located. This is the molding in the Owens-Thomas House dining room, and this is the molding in one of the rooms at the William Mason Smith House in Charleston. He uses anthemia a lot, or honeysuckle. It's a stylized flower that you'll see throughout ancient architecture that pops up in his work. Columbia Place in Cheltenham, and you see this again at Sir John Soane's house here in London. So I made reference to the breakfast room. So this is the breakfast room at Sir John Soane's house in England. This is the entranceway, the ceiling to the entranceway of the house in Brixton, England, when he was apprenticed to Roper. This is the ceiling of the drawing room at the Owens-Thomas house. And this is the entranceway to the William Mason Smith house in Charleston, these two here. So you see how these design elements are weaving their way through architects to the work that William Jay does. Skylights, I mentioned skylights and colored lights. So this is the Greek key design with amber light in the dining room, the niche in the dining room at the Owens-Thomas house. This is the skylights, different colors, different shapes and sizes over the museum that Sir John Soane built at the back of his house. And these are two skylights that were found in the gentleman's home who invited us over at Paragon Buildings. I was so excited to see this because the woman from America, her house did not have these windows, skylights, and it was very excited to see these original skylights in this J building. The Greek key comes up again and again and again. So again, looking to antiquity, but also his most recent influences, including Sir John Soane, again in the breakfast room. It's hard to see here, but the Greek key design along the molding here, the ceiling here, in Brixton at Brockwell Hall. This very similar to the molding here at the William Mason Smith House in Charleston, the dining room at the Owens-Thomas House. This is the ironwork on the front of the Telfair Academy. This is William Mason Smith House in Charleston and the dining room, drawing room at the Owens-Thomas House. And there are other examples. Diocletian windows. And so Diocletian window, that's this shape right here. and you see it. So as I mentioned, the Emperor Diocletian, he retired to what is now Croatia. And this was in 18th century, a very important site. Well, it still is. It's a World Heritage Site. Robert Adam went there, and he did extensive drawings, which he published. And William Jay would have seen these drawings. You see it pop up. This is Chiswick House in London. And then you see it pop up in William Jay's designs too. So here at the Telfair Academy, which is echoed, you can't really see it because of the bushes here, but when you go walk by the Telfair Academy, you'll see it, that it's echoed below the porch here. And then here at the Ships of the Sea, the Habersham House as well. Staircases. So William Jay seemed to really have a thing for staircases. And you see that in his houses. This is the Bullock House. So you have six columns capped with gilded Corinthian capitals with this spiral staircase. How amazing is that? Doesn't it just hurt your heart that this building was torn down? I know. Okay, never mind. Every time I think about this, it just kills me to think that this house no longer exists. And then here you have the grand staircase at the Owens-Thomas House, which leads to a bridge. And these are all details of the staircase, which is kind of hard to capture because it's in a relatively small space. At the William Mason Smith House, which I referenced earlier, again, there's the dome. And so here's the dome looking up. This is at the top looking down, another looking down, and a detail there. More on the staircases here and influences. So all of these images here reference, including this drawing here, reference the staircase at Home House. It's a club now in London, originally designed by Robert Adam. William Jay may or may not have visited there, but the designs, the drawings of the space were available at the time of William Jay's period. So here is this colonnade that frames the staircase. You can see this is another view of it. And, you know, very similar to the framing of the staircase at the Owens-Thomas House. This staircase goes up in circles completely around, whereas the staircase at the Owens-Thomas House, you go up and it comes around and turns into a bridge. And so I'm going to end there, back with the most well-known homes designed by William Jay in Savannah, but really I think in America. His best work was made in the United States. Thank you. Are there any questions? Yes.
You mentioned this is generally called Regency style, is that correct? Mm-hmm. Is there a group of architects or one architect in particular that put forth this particular style that's known as Regency? What does that mean?
Yeah, so Regency is really making reference to the Prince Regent, and he had such an influence. Such an influence on the arts and architecture and design of the time because of his own particular interests. And he worked very closely with John Nash. And so I would say that the two standout Regency architects would be John Nash and Sir John Soane. And so there are different elements, you know, as I talked about along the way, but a lot of those elements pop up at different time periods, like the Greek key, for example. But there are certain things that seem to be focused in that time period, like the use of light and the skylights and the colored glass, and the uniquely shaped spaces, the uniquely shaped rooms. Painted ceilings was very common at that time.
Is that type of entry unique to Regency or is it common?
No, I mean, this is making reference to these porches are making reference to Greek and Roman architecture. And so while none of these are exact duplicates of that period, like the Arch of Constantine that you saw on the Kettleston, the Robert Adams designed Kettleston Hall, they're still making reference to that architecture. Yes?
Given that William J. was so desired in this period to be homes in Savannah and he left fairly quickly, are there homes in Savannah now that you believe had a direct influence after William J.'s style that were not designed by him?
That's a great question. I think that you see the influence of William J. in other buildings, but I don't know. I can't think of any right now off the top of my head. Luciana?
I can't either, actually. Yeah, mm-hmm. But that would be a really interesting study for somebody to kind of survey the landscape of the 1820s after he left.
Yeah, I agree. Yes?
Is there any one or two elements of his designs that you could attribute solely to him? I mean, I know he was influenced by all these things that you pulled from, that you've covered. Is there anything that is uniquely his?
I think that his staircases seem to be unique. So the staircase at the Owens-Thomas House, for example, there's a curator who works for Historic Royal Palaces in England who is doing a book on staircases. And he came to visit a few years ago and he looked at the staircase at the Owens-Thomas House and he had never seen a staircase like this. And he is studying staircases in England. He's doing a history of staircases in England. And so I think that that was something that was very unique to William J. From the evidence that exists and doesn't exist, including the Bullock House staircase. I mean, that's quite a statement. And I think that maybe the staircases were a way for him to maybe work on a grander scale in a smaller space. And that helped him, make a splash, so to speak, with the architecture and the elements and the space that he had to work with. Jamie?
Well, and that bank, is this the only place you've ever seen the bridge? I mean, is this
is the only place that I've ever seen a bridge. I've heard people say that they've seen bridges, although I can't get them to tell me exactly where. And then my friend who is writing this book, he has never seen a bridge in England. So, yes.
Well, I'm wondering if your research of the Regency style, if there's other architects who've been able to scale down with his mastery. I mean, that maybe that's a skill he had that others didn't have.
Yeah, I think that's a good observation and one that I haven't pursued. So now you all have given me two things to work on. Anyone else?
Yeah? Have you seen that amber window like that before?
Yeah, at Sir John Soane's museum. Yeah. Anybody else? Okay, well, thank you for your time.